Okay, so last video I showed you this programming language I made, ugly but works, and we compiled this into this weird binary format. And then you pass this binary file to this program called invoice and it executes our program. In the last video I also showed you that the beginning of this binary format actually triggers a buffer overflow and overwrites the return pointer on the stack. And at that point you might have thought that our programs are simply shellcode, so assembler code that we inject and then jump to with the buffer overflow. But that is not even possible because the stack is not executable. So even though we cannot inject actual assembler instructions to execute, we somehow were still able to execute my programs. And at this point it's pretty clear that this is possible thanks to return-oriented programming. So let's examine how this works. But I warn you, you really need to get your brain into an abstract philosophical thinking mode. This will get weird, and maybe you have to rewatch it sometime in the future, maybe check out some more normal return-oriented programming tutorials and then come back to this. But if you get this video, I think it will add to a much greater and deeper understanding for you. So just try. Anyway, let's head in. So, in x86 assembler, there is an instruction called call, and call actually does two things. First, it pushes the return address, which is the address immediately after the call instruction, onto the stack. And then it changes EIP, the current instruction pointer, to the call destination. So the CPU continues execution there. Now, when we in C call a function, this will be compiled to an assembler call instruction. But to understand return-oriented programming, you have to forget this. Ignore the concept of calling functions. Simply remember that this instruction pushes the address immediately after the call instruction onto the stack and then sets the instruction pointer to the target address. And the return instruction behaves in the same way. Yes, RET is compiled from a return in C, but forget this connection. RET simply pops an address, we call it the return address, off the stack and sets the instruction pointer back to that. And popping a value from the stack is also already again an abstract interpretation. What it literally means is, it looks at the stack pointer register, follows that address and takes that value. And then it increments the stack pointer register. It increments because the stack rolls downwards, so if we shrink it, when we pop a value we increase it so it goes closer to the highest address again. Anyway, this is what RET does. It's taking this value where the stack register points to, increments the stack pointer address, and then uses that value it got to set the instruction pointer. That's how we return in quotation marks. So this was lesson one. Ignore the name of the instruction or its typical meaning and typical usage. Just understand what the instruction itself does. So again, remember what the RET return instruction does. First look at the stack register, follow this address and take that value, increment the stack pointer, set the instruction pointer to that value, done. Now let's think about something else. What does it mean for a machine to execute instructions? A CPU is a piece of hardware that executes instructions. Those instructions are machine code or assembler code, right? How does that in an abstract sense work? Well, there's memory where instructions are stored and this memory has addresses. Then the CPU has an instruction pointer register that contains an address that points to memory with the next instruction to execute. So if it's 0, it will execute this. And then it does whatever this instruction is defined to do. Not that important what this instruction exactly does, but by executing any instruction, the instruction pointer is simply incremented and moved forward to point to the next instruction. And then that gets executed and the instruction pointer will be updated to point to the next one, and so forth. Of course, that changes with instructions like jumps or calls or returns where the instruction pointer is directly updated, but you get it. A computer, really in an abstract sense, is a machine that, given instruction, computes or executes those instructions. So the CPU is a machine implemented in hardware. But of course, there are also virtual machines, so machines implemented on top of our CPU machines. And for example, the JVM, the Java Virtual Machine, behaves in the same way. It is a machine. So there's bytecode somewhere in memory, and their software, the JVM, has an instruction pointer, or they are called program counter, PC, that points to the next instruction, or they are called opcode. And when the JVM executes one opcode, it also has to update the program counter and move it to the next one. Here I looked up the source code for that. So here's the OpenJDK source code, and there you see an update PC and continue macro where it literally adds the size or length of the current opcode onto the program counter, so this moves it forward, like the CPU would increment the instruction pointer. So this is lesson two. A machine in an abstract sense is simple. There's memory that holds code or instructions, and the machine points to that code, takes an instruction, executes it, and then updates the program counter to point to the next one. So, what the F does this have to do with return-oriented programming? Well, last video, I also introduced the concept of a weird machine. Somehow this invoice program implemented a weird machine. And I know that concept was super confusing, but bear with me, it will make sense in a moment. If this invoice program implements a weird machine, and you program that weird machine with a technique called return-oriented programming, then you should ask yourself now, where is the memory that contains our instructions? Where is the instruction pointer that points to those instructions? And where is the logic that executes whatever an instruction is defined to do? Well, luckily we have some example programs and we can debug this weird machine with GDB. Let's load the invoice program into GDB and let's learn how it executes. I don't want to explain buffer overflows again, please check out my binary exploitation playlist for that. But when you are familiar with it, you know that we overwrote stuff on the stack. If you look at the addInvoice function, you can find the dangerous function gets, which cause the buffer overflow. So we can set a breakpoint here and we set one at the return. Then let's run the binary, and as an input we pass in the hello world.binary. And we know now that input triggers the buffer overflow. So here we hit the breakpoint at the gets. If we execute the gets and examine the stack, we can find all of our input here. Here all of the A's that fill up the buffer, and then we have these randomly looking but actually carefully chosen values after it. But let's go forward to the return instruction. So we are about to execute the return, and please remember what return means. It looks at the address in the stack register, so here this address points to this memory, so this is the stack and that's the top element. And the return instruction now takes that value as an address and sets the instruction pointer to it. And at the same time, it increments the stack pointer. So let's do that. Single step forward, and now let's compare before and after the return. It did exactly what we expected. The stack pointer register was incremented from hex 18 to hex 20, so move 8 bytes forward, and the instruction pointer got set to the value previously on top of the stack. By the way, when we execute the ret, we also often use the phrase we return into something. It doesn't matter if we say we return to, say we returned into, or say we continued execution here, it's all the same. Don't get confused by the term return. You know what the ret instruction really does. It simply takes a value from the stack and sets the instruction pointer to it. Anyway, so what happens now? Where is our instruction pointer pointing to? It points here to this assembler code, a pop RDX and a pop RBX, followed by another return. So this means it takes one value from the stack and puts it into RDX, increments RSP again, then takes the next value on the stack and moves it into RBX, increments RSP, and then we are at the return again. And now return takes the next value on the stack and sets the instruction pointer to it. So where does it now continue executing? Okay, so now we are here. Here we have a pop RDI. So it takes the next value on the stack, moves it into RDI, and then comes ret, which takes the next value and sets the instruction pointer to it. So where are we now? Now we execute a move. We move EDX into the address pointed to by RDI. And remember when we set EDX? The pop RDX at the beginning set the value of EDX to the value we had on the stack. And RDI, the address where we now write to, we also had on the stack and got it into RDI with a pop RDI. Think about what this code now did. I know it looked weird, but all it did was it moved the value we wanted into an address we specified. We moved the value into RDX, then an address into RDI, and then we wrote that EDX value to the address RDI points to. Now look at the source code of the Hello World program. Here the code said we moved the string hell, which is of course 4 bytes, into the variable 4, and then store variable 4 in memory location 1. And that is just another way of saying we move the string of the 4 bytes hell into RDX, and then we move RDX to the memory location we specify in RDI. which memory location and converting the string hello to the 4 bytes is what my compiler program does. I know, maybe this is a bit too confusing, maybe better just ignore my compiler shenanigans. But if you think about what we did, we executed these few instructions that move a value into some memory location, and we did that by using super weird instructions, which we usually refer to as gadgets. To perform this memory write, we used three gadgets. First, we used a pop-rdx pop-rbx gadget, then a pop-rdi gadget, and then a move gadget. And see what all these gadgets have in common? They all end with a return instruction. Now bend your mind. Take what we just witnessed and try to fit it into the concept of a machine executing instructions. First, we have memory that is our stack. On there, we had all these addresses and values. And in a weird, fucked up way, the stack pointer was our instruction pointer, right? Our weird machine basically started with the return opcode, which took the first address on the stack and continued the CPU execution there. Then the stack pointer pointed to the next value, we popped it and moved it to the next, popped another value, moved it to the next, and then came another return which took the value and let the CPU execute code there, moving the stack pointer again to the next value. So in a way, those addresses on the stack when we have a return define an instruction handler, right? You could say this address here is actually the opcode, the instruction to perform a pop-rdx and then a pop-rbx. And this other gadget, this address here, is the opcode for the move of edx into the address of rdi. Isn't this basically the same thing how a x86 assembler call instruction actually means we push an address on the stack and set the instruction pointer to the given destination? How is that call x86 instruction different from our weird machine gadget? It isn't. Both define some action, what it does, and then the machine moves to the next instruction. The CPU does this by incrementing the instruction pointer, the Java virtual machine does this by simply incrementing the program counter, and our weird machine does this by incrementing the stack pointer. I know these gadgets are super weird instructions, and each program, depending on how much code it contains and what kind of functions were written there and where in memory the compiler places the code, changes what kind of gadgets are available. With the small tool drop gadgets, we can actually list all the gadgets, so assembler snippets that have this pattern of a few instructions followed by a red. Basically, these are all the weird instructions that we can use to implement whatever we want on this weird machine. I know it's crappy. Nobody said that this has to be a well thought out machine like the CPU or the Java virtual machine, but it's enough to basically perform any kind of computation. It was enough for me to collect gadgets that seemed useful and build a compiler that translates this text representation to actual addresses that points to these gadgets. And that's why each program with such a vulnerability accidentally crafts its own weird machine. Each vulnerable program will have its own instruction set, its own collection of gadgets, and its own initialization code that sets up that weird machine, basically the code that triggered our vulnerability in the first place. So writing such an exploit is in essence the setting up and instantiation of a weird machine by triggering the buffer overflow, and then we program that weird machine with a rob chain, a collection of gadgets chained together that will be executed by our weird machine, thanks to how the x86 read instruction together with the stack works. And what we can program is just bound by our creativity and availability of useful gadgets. But if you have a large amount of gadgets, you can understand that you could implement anything you want. You just chain these small assembler snippets together to build anything. In an attack, you usually try to create a remote shell or something, but it could literally be just a regular program, like I have created these rob chains that, for example, take two numbers as an input, adds them together and prints the result. That is return-oriented programming, explained in a super confusing way. I know, this is maybe not the best rob tutorial, but there are so many normal tutorials that I just wanted to try something different, and I hope that there are some of you where this kind of different angle on the topic is mind-opening. At least for me, this was so mind-blowing and beautiful that, as you know, it became a slogan for my channel. Also, I'd like to remind you to check the papers and talks I've listed in the description. Please read them, even if you didn't understand this video. They are maybe better, but certainly more correct explaining this concept of weird machines and exploit development. Anyway, Thanks for watching, and maybe check out my Patreon and YouTube membership in the description.